Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Pastor David Mertz. I have the privilege of serving as president of Great Plains Lutheran High School. I'd like to welcome you to our virtual Grandparents Day. It's a little bit different, obviously, than we have had in previous years, but we wanted to continue with our Grandparents Day to let you know that your role in your grandchildren's life is very important to them, and it's very important to us as a school. As we get started today, I'd like to just comment on the mission of our school. Our mission is to assist families in nurturing students as lifelong disciples of Christ. And we've been blessed to do that for more than 24 years. In fact, this is our 25th year, and we're celebrating that fact throughout the year under the theme of All to the Glory of God. We thank God that we have been enabled in many ways to do so many things to God's glory over the past 25 years. We're seeking to do things to God's glory this year, during the school year, and we're looking forward to many more years of doing all things to the glory of God. So we're excited about having that as our theme this year as we gather together as a school. We're thanking God for that, and we're also thanking God for you, grandparents. We thank you because of the role that you have in a lot of different ways, but especially now today in the lives of your grandchildren. The roles that you play as mentors to them, as Christian models for them, that's all so very important. I believe that being a teenager has always been a challenging time of life. I also believe that being a teenager in today's world is as challenging as it ever has been. And so the support of God's people around teens is as important as ever. So the words of encouragement that you have for your grandchildren is important. The prayers that you offer up for them is important. As I said, the modeling of Christian faith and life that you do for them and with them is so important. So the offerings that you give to your grandchildren in so many ways are things that we praise God for today, that we thank Him for today, and we celebrate today. We do have a lot to celebrate. If you are on our website, some of you have gotten to the live stream via our website. On the main page of our website, you're going to see that we're obviously celebrating our 25th anniversary, but there is a tab there. It's a brown tab that says GPL 25th anniversary. I'd like to direct you to that. When you have some time later, perhaps right after today's program, you could click on that GPL 25 anniversary link, and you're going to find there a video, about a 6.5 minute video, which recounts and celebrates the many blessings that God has given to us as a school and looks at some of the exciting things that we are looking forward to. That's going to be noted in that video. You can also find some of those exciting things under another tab, the United in Praise tab. That's our facility expansion plan, which is even now being carried out. If you were here on campus today, you would see evidence of that through site work that's being done, footings that are being poured, perhaps even as I am speaking. Things are moving forward with the construction of our chapel, auditorium, music area, and soon our kitchen and cafeteria area, and we hope not too far down the line, an auxiliary gym and a classroom addition. These are all exciting things that we're celebrating now, and we're thankful for the support that you give to us in so many ways. So, we celebrate grandparents today. We thank you for the support that you give to your grandchildren and to our school. And to talk about another way in which you are blessed to do that, another thing we are thankful for, is our Director of Mission Advancement. I'm so going to invite him forward, Pastor Paul Lindhorst.
Thank you, President Mertz. I also want to thank you for the many ways in which you show support to your grandchildren, children in particular today, as you support their being here at Great Plains Lutheran High School. You know, we hear a lot about legacies today, and we hear phrases like leave a legacy, make a legacy gift, or what will be your legacy? And as we think about these things, these phrases seem to be a part of our end of life and or financial discussions a lot these days. And in most cases, the folks who are talking to you or to us about these types of things are suggesting that you leave something behind, that you make your mark in this world so that people will remember you. But we also recognize the fact that it is not about me, is it? In fact, the Apostle Paul said something very, very important about that in 2 Corinthians when he said, if you want to boast about something, boast in the Lord. So if you want to brag about someone or something, let it not be about yourself, but rather let it be about the one who left heaven to submit himself totally and fully to the law which he had given to us, so that he might keep that perfectly and go to the cross where he would pay the ultimate price, the whole price necessary that God demanded be paid for our sins and the sins of everyone in the whole world, and defeat sin and Satan right there, and then allow his body to die so that 3 days later he might destroy our final enemy, namely death. So if we want to boast in something, let us boast about him. And that sounds very similar to what Pastor Mertz said a moment ago, our theme for the day, our theme for the year. If you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. That's what we want to do, is give God all of our glory. We grandparents realize that our greatest legacy is not something or some place or some space. Now, yes, these things and spaces and places are important tools that we can use to gain and get, basically achieve our greatest legacy goal. But none of these things are our primary legacy. Our God-entrusted legacy is our children, our grandchildren, and the generations to follow. And so if there's one thing that we ought to invest our energies and treasures in, it's our multi-generational family's eternal future and reaching the lost with the gospel. Many of you recognize this and are working already hard towards, you know, this eternally important goal by providing support in the ways that Pastor Mertz just talked about, and also by providing support of some or maybe even all of your grandchild's tuition and dorm fees. Many of you are working hard for this eternally important goal by providing regular, generous offerings for the day-to-day operation of the Great Plains Lutheran High School ministry, and or by providing over and above gifts for the creation of tools here on this campus so that our grandchildren and future generations will have a great opportunity to learn about their Savior and about his life-steadying word, as well as enabling them to better utilize all of their gifts and talents, all to the glory of God. And some of you as well are also already working hard towards this eternally important goal. But for those of you who are not yet, I want to encourage you to get your house in order. If you have not done so yet, getting your house in order, that is, prepare your estate plan so that you can continue to support this Christ-centered, faith-strengthening GPLHS ministry after you leave this world and enter into heaven through faith in Jesus Christ. Fellow grandparents, using the resources that God has given us to build up many people in their saving faith and to lead still others to come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior here at Great Plains. This is a great way to give all glory to God. And with the worldwide events that have really come to the fore these past 7 or 8 months, the ministry of GPLHS and God's encouraging word are now more important and necessary than ever before. And here to speak with you more about these recent events and GPL's place among them is our principal, Mr. Matthew Bauer.
Good afternoon. As Pastor Lindhorst mentioned, my name is Matt Bauer. I have the privilege of serving as principal here at Great Plains Lutheran High School. I'm beginning my third year of service. There's so much I could talk to you about this afternoon, but you know, something that's definitely been on our minds a lot in the last 6 months has been the COVID-19 situation, and I'm going to share some information with you this afternoon just to give you a feel for how things are going at GPL and how things are being affected, and by God's grace, how we're pushing through this. First of all, going back to last spring, we sent the kids home on spring break, and in the back of our minds already, we knew that we might not be seeing them again for several weeks, possibly the rest of the school year, as indeed it played out that way. So we sent them home with all their books. And over the course of the spring break, our teachers rallied and we figured out our game plan for how we were going to continue our education online. We call it distance learning. And by and large, that went very well. Our faculty and our students were resilient and made the most of that situation. So we were able to finish the fourth quarter of the school year remotely. Strange times, I guess you could say, but it went pretty well. We finished up the year and we decided to give our graduates the best that we could at the time, which was a recorded graduation ceremony. And we told them that if the circumstances allowed and the climate and so forth were such later in the summer that we could come back together in person, we would do that. In July, we were able to come back for an on-site graduation celebration. It was really a nice evening, gave people the opportunity to see each other again who hadn't seen each other for quite a while, brought some closure to the school year. We actually were able to have the groundbreaking ceremony for our facility expansion project that evening as well, and then the whole thing wrapped up with an awesome fireworks show. So it turned out to be a very special evening and a good send-off for our graduates. And then the question became, what was this school year going to look like? So throughout the summer, we started working on plans for a safe return to school. That was a challenging process because so much about these virus circumstances are constantly changing, so it seemed like we were shooting for a moving target. But finally, we got to the point where we felt we had enough information and enough of a feel for how things needed to go that we developed a safe return to school plan. And, you know, starting on day one, August 24th, we've been here, and now we've got 5 weeks under our belts of successful on-site school year. So we are eternally thankful to God that that's been possible so far. Some aspects of our safe return to school plan. Maybe you've heard your grandchild talking to you about the fact that we are requiring face coverings. That's one of the things that we feel is in the best interest of everybody on our campus, trying to prevent the transmission of the virus, not only among our school family, but also to those we encounter outside of school. We're doing our best to accomplish distancing when we can. Largely, our plan aims at appropriate and practical measures that we can take to try to keep people safe, priority number one, and then priority number two, keep the doors open. And we realize that each week that passes is a gift, is a blessing, not something that we can take for granted. We have heard in recent days and recent weeks that there are some schools not too far away from us who have had to close their doors on site and go to distance learning for a period of time because of the virus transmission and the people determined to be close contacts in their school and so forth. So we're doing our absolute best. We're thankful for the effort of our students and our faculty and everybody involved, the support that's being shared. And like I said, each week, each day is a gift of God. We've got five under our belts now. We're looking forward to going into the sixth next week with our full family back together again. So we're in this together. We're all trying to do our part to be responsible and keep the full program of Christian education, the day-to-day, you know, school day, but then all the activities that benefit our students and those activities that they treasure so much, trying to keep it all in play. And we're thankful that we've been able to do that so far. So thank you for your time and giving you an update on how things are going at GPL, especially as we're plowing through these uncharted territories of COVID-19. It's now my privilege to introduce to you one more speaker. We're going to bring up a student. He's a member of our student council. He's a senior. He's a very pleasant young man. His name is Austin Adams, and he's just going to give you a feel for who he is and what GPL means to him.
My name is Austin Adams, and I am from Salt Lake City, Utah. I'm a senior this year. I participate in the student council and am running cross country. I help with tech and I participate in track in the spring. Great Plains is a truly special place. I really love it here. I was talking to a fellow student last night and he said something that really kind of clicked with me. He said, the relationships you make here are truly special. Every time you come here, you get to meet someone new, you have some new interaction that just means a lot. And part of that comes from being in dorm school. You get to spend a lot of time with certain people, and you just grow in certain friendships, and especially with God's help, everything here is fantastic. I think that's about it. Thank you, grandparents.
Thank you, Austin. I know it's not an easy thing to get up in front of people and share what's on your mind and on your heart, but we appreciate that as you share that with grandparents today. I don't know if you could tell or not, but we don't have our student body in here yet, but we're going to invite them in now to join us for what comes next, and that is our chapel devotion. As they are coming in, I'm going to play a song that's been arranged for our anniversary year, and it's got some pictures, a slideshow, so to speak, to go along with it. So you can enjoy that as the students join us for our chapel time. For the grandparents who are tuning in, again, we know that you couldn't be here today to see a lot of those things, but hope that some of the pictures there gave you a little glimpse of life at GPL, some of the pictures from last year, some from this year. I'd like to continue with our devotion in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. One of the things that I get to do is visit our Lutheran elementary schools in the area and share a message from God's word with them and encouragement with them. And this week I had to share a few of these thoughts with a couple of our grade schools. And I started out with this question: why is it important to get a good education? And there are different ways that people can answer that. Some might answer that by saying something like this: you want to get a good education so that you can get a good job. You want to get a good job so that you can earn good money. You want to get a good job so that maybe you can get a better job, so that you can earn even more money, so that you can buy for yourself or your family or whomever the things that you would like to have and use in this life. And maybe even set aside something for retirement so that you can live comfortably later on in life. Those are some reasons for getting a good education. And those things are not necessarily bad. They can be fine in and of themselves. But really, when it comes to education, we're here because we believe that there is something more to it than that. And so that question leads me to this next question, and that is this: why is it important to get a Christian education? If you saw the line of books on the previous slide, those same books are appearing on this slide, but they are shaped around the cross, because Christian education is shaped by the cross of Jesus Christ. And it is founded, it is built on that foundation of God's word. And why is that so important? If we look at our theme verse for this year, it says in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31, so whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. So how do those things fit together? If you are going to do all things to the glory of God, you need to know what God has done for us in Christ Jesus. You need to know how Jesus was born for us, came to this earth for us. You need to know how he lived perfectly for us. You need to know how he learned perfectly and how he taught perfectly. You need to know how he lived perfectly in every way and then suffered and died perfectly in payment for our sins. You need to know that he went to the grave for you, and you need to know that he rose again and ascended into heaven and even now is ruling and interceding on your behalf. You need to know those things about your Savior Jesus in order to do all things to the glory of God. That's why Christian education is so important. But let's take that a step further. If I want to do all things to the glory of God, how do I do that on a daily basis? What does that sound like? What does that look like? If we look at another verse from this same chapter, chapter 10, verse 24, the Apostle Paul said, "No one should seek their own good, but the good of others." So his reminder for us today is to honor God by seeking the good of others, by putting others ahead of ourselves, putting others ahead of you. That is seen, for example, when grandparents do things that put their grandchildren's welfare ahead of their own. It could show itself in a lot of different ways. Maybe it shows itself at times by grandchildren doing things that show their grandparents that they are loved and that they are important. In fact, putting their grandparents ahead of themselves and their own wants and their own needs. And that can be shown in a lot of different ways as we interact with a lot of different people. When I was at those grade schools earlier this week, I asked the children, the youngsters, to think about that and offer some suggestions. And they talked about things like sharing clothes with people who need clothing, sharing food with people who need food, sharing money with people who need money. And those are all good things that the people of God, that you and I, that we can do. But there's, again, something more that we can think about as we take another step. Another verse from this same chapter says, Paul again writing, "For I am not seeking my own good, but the good of many, so that they may be saved." Which reminds us that he did not just have people's earthly welfare in mind. He had people's spiritual and eternal welfare in mind. And so when he saw a person and looked at what might be good for that person and put that other person ahead of himself and his own welfare, he saw them in terms of heaven. He saw them in terms of eternity. And he thought in terms of, what can I do to connect this person to Jesus Christ, their Savior, so that they might know that same Savior that I know, so that they might look forward to heaven in the same way that I look forward to heaven, so that they too might experience eternal life. And again, we can take that as an encouragement for us as we gather here together today. How can I live and do all things to the glory of God? I can do that by putting others ahead of myself, putting their welfare first, and doing that with a spiritual, eternal perspective. How can I let heaven and eternity impact my life and choices today? And how can my life and choices today impact eternity for myself and for others? We thank God today for the many ways that that has happened, thinking particularly of the relationship between grandchildren and grandparents. It's not a perfect relationship. It's not a perfect world. It's sinners interacting with one another. But it is an avenue. It is a place. It is a way where the love of God is demonstrated as God's people live with one another. And then we're encouraged to take that beyond that framework today and to think of the other people who are sitting around us, thinking of the other people that we're going to interact with this weekend, thinking of the other people in our lives, thinking of the people we don't even know yet, who may or may not know Jesus as their Savior, but who we will have the opportunity to share that message with. And again, that's what Christian education is all about. That's why we're here today. That's why we come together day after day. That's why this school exists. That's why our mission is to nurture students as lifelong disciples of Christ. That's why our education is shaped around the cross of Christ and built on the foundation of God's word. Because it is that word and promise of God that makes an eternal difference. And we pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessing of this day. We thank you for the opportunity for grandchildren to connect with their grandparents. We thank you for the opportunity to celebrate and thank you for your love in Jesus. And we thank you for opportunities to share that love with the people around us. Help us each and every day to do all things to your glory. Help us to frame that in our minds and in our hearts, in our lives, in a way that puts the welfare of others ahead of our own. And above all, does that with a spiritual and an eternal perspective. Lord, may we glorify you as we strive to do that. And may you be honored by all we think and say and do. Continue to bless us in our roles, whether that be as grandparents, grandchildren, students, teachers, the family of God, in and through Jesus, our Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. The next thing that we have on our agenda is to give you another glimpse of life here at GPL. We're going to ask our band to come forward. They were at a marching band event yesterday. I believe yesterday was Arlington, and next week they'll be in Aberdeen. As they are transitioning, I'm going to play that song for you again so you can listen in, think about that, as the band and the color guard get ready to go.
Sing of my Redeemer and his wife. I was just going to make a quick announcement. Bailey Wolf is our drum major. She's also a trumpet player in the band. And today, she's not going to be directing the band because we need her to play trumpet. So she's going to play trumpet for us, but Bailey Wolf is our drum major and leads us down the street.
Again, we'd like to welcome grandparents to our Grandparents' Day. Thank you for tuning in. That's the end of our program for today. God's blessings to you in whatever you have in store for the rest of your day and your weekend. And I don't know if it'll come through at all, but if the students want to say one quick final shout out to the grandparents, say hi, Grandma, hi, Grandma. On three, one, two, three, ready, go. All right, thanks for coming. God's blessings.